This podcast is brought to you by the Albany Public Library Main Branch and the generosity of listeners like you.
What is a podcast?
God, Daddy, these people talk as much as you do. Razib Khan's Unsupervised Learning.
Hey, everybody. Thanks for joining us on the Unsupervised Learning podcast. I am here joined today by my friend, Dr. James Lee. James is a professor at the University of Minnesota. His field of study is psychology, but he is quite interdisciplinary, and he's done a lot of work on genomics. He's been the authors on the educational attainment papers, which some of you may have heard about, and he is an author on the most recent educational attainment paper, EA4, that just came out, and we will talk about that in a bit. But in the beginning, I am going to talk to James about behavior genetics, genomics, population genetics, and how these fields interact with each other, and just some controversies, confusions, disputes that have emerged about the validity of these fields and interdisciplinary crosstalk. But James, would you want to say anything else about your work and what you're doing right now?
No, Razib, not too much. You've about covered it. I am a behavioral geneticist here at the University of Minnesota. This is a specialty our department has done for quite a while, going back to studies of twins and twins separated at birth. And we still do that kind of thing, but now we do these kinds of genomic studies that you were just mentioning.
Awesome. So first, for a lot of listeners out there, genetics is genetics. But, as as some of the other listeners know, there's many different fields. So, you have developmental geneticists who they want to see how genes are expressed in tissues and how that allows for the emergence of organs and body plans and things like that. There's evolutionary geneticists that are focused on the allele frequencies and go back to Fisher, Sewell, Wright, Haldane, that sort of thing. Molecular geneticists can focus, their whole career on a particular mechanism. Population geneticists, which are closely related to evolutionary geneticists, population genetics is a major tool in evolutionary genetics, right? And that's just focusing on kind of like deducing from formal models, just how evolution proceeds over time and how it might proceed over time. And then there's behavior geneticists. And so I was just going to put it out there. I've had some discussions with people about this. A lot of population geneticists and evolutionary geneticists don't really respect behavior geneticists. They think it gives the field, it gives genetics a bad name. Its history is very checkered, associated with eugenics, which, I mean, to be candid, population and evolutionary genetics are also associated with eugenics. So I think that's I don't think that's fair. Okay. But in any case, there's a lot of back and forth around these topics, and I think there's some confusion. And behavior genetics, a lot of behavior geneticists, not all, they come out of psychology, so it is a different disciplinary orientation, a different community. You have some people, Nick Martin, Peter Vischer, Naomi Ray. There's some quantitative genetics people that kind of span pop gen and behavior genetics and may contribute to both. And so, there are common languages, there's a common lexicon there. And ultimately, these concepts like heritability, genetic architecture, where it's like, okay, like, is a polygenic trait over hundreds of, positions in the genomic map, or is it a monogenic trait? These are common concepts to behavior genetics and population genetics. So the two groups can talk to each other, but they have some differences in terms of focus and emphasis. And I want to start out by talking about like a mild controversy that's been happening recently around Paige Harden's book, The Genetic Lottery, which, I give it a relatively positive review, which I'm not sure if that was good for her in terms of its reception in the genetics community in Unheard last summer, although I had some major disagreements. But on the science part, my disagreements were, and this again, like, damns her to some people, to be candid, but in any case, we're pretty marginal. whereas, you know, on the political part, I had some bigger disagreements, but, you know, this is neither here nor there. A lot of population geneticists have really serious disagreements with Harden's work, but really, I think they have serious disagreements just with behavior genetics and its model of causality.
Yeah, I haven't been following this controversy, so maybe you could fill me in. What?
Yeah, and I'll fill the listeners in. So,
scientific nature of the dispute.
Yeah. So, Lottery Luck or Legacy is a preprint that Graham Coop has posted on his site GC Bias. And you can find the preprint. It's the latest posting. He wrote it with Molly Shorsky at she's out of Columbia, and it mostly addresses aspects of the science. I think in the Harden book and in behavior genetics. So here's what the biggest technical thing that they address are they okay. So let me start out with the generality, and I want you to answer that, and then I'm going to go into some specifics. So I guess the basic issue that they have is these GWASs on behavior. Harden, like many behavior genomicists and geneticists, including you, point out that the genes that you get on the genome-wide association, so the genes that are associated with educational attainment or intelligence, or I don't know, some behavioral phenotype, schizophrenia or autism, they tend to be expressed in the brains as opposed to other tissues. So that should update your prior in terms of, okay, is this biologically significant, even if you don't have a mechanistic understanding of every single step in the process biochemically, from gene to protein to phenomenon. And so I guess what Coop and Prezworski have an issue with is they don't think you've established causality. There's environmental heterogeneity, and you don't know for sure that just because it's expressed in the brain, it is actually even should be updating your priors, because the brain is such a complex organism where so many pathways just end up there. Maybe it's just coincidental that it's expressed in the brain. It's expressed in a lot of other tissues. I think the stylized fact last I remember is a third of human genes, of the 19,000 genes, are expressed in the brain. So, I mean, there is a lot of gene expression there. So that's one of their major issues. And I guess the question that I would start out with is okay, the model of causality. I know that, you're a big fan of Judea Pearl, and one of, a population geneticist friend of mine, was expressing serious skepticism. And, this is someone who is actually positively disposed to Harden and behavior genetics project as a whole, that, the model of causality is not persuasive, and that Lewontin's criticisms having to do with environmental heterogeneity hold. I mean, what is your simple response to that critique?
So the issue is that we can do a GWAS and we can assess many SNPs, millions of them, basically for whether they're correlated with the phenotype that we're studying, whether this is height or type 2 diabetes or IQ or schizophrenia or autism or whatever the trait may be. We can get some hits, we can get some summary statistics of the entire study. But there is always the possibility that when you see a significant correlation between a SNP and the trait, that this is not because of a causal relationship, whereas if I could reach in there and flip that SNP, that would have some result in some change in the phenotype. Instead, it could be that the SNP is just correlated with something else that is affecting the phenotype. So in genetic epidemiology, there's an apocryphal story. I think it originated in a paper that came out around 2000, talking about, chopstick gene. This is what they call it. So the story asks us to imagine that there's a geneticist who's interested in the genetic basis of chopstick skill. And so he conducts a GWAS, or, whatever they called it back then, a study looking for genetic markers correlated with chopstick skill. And this geneticist happens to find such a SNP in a sample. And he's very pleased with having found the genetic basis for chopstick skill. But then other scientists failed to replicate the result. And it turns out that the reason why there was a significant result in the first place was that the original sample was actually a mixture of Europeans and East Asians. Now, Europeans and East Asians differ in the frequencies of genetic variants, allele frequencies, mostly because of genetic drift. That is, the random change in allele frequencies in each of these two populations subsequent to their last time they shared common ancestors. And then East Asians are better at chopsticks for reasons that presumably have nothing or little to do with genetics. And the end result is that any SNP that differs in frequency between Europeans and East Asians in a study with a not-so-careful design is going to look like it is correlated with chopstick skill, that it causally affects chopstick skill, or is highly correlated with a nearby SNP in the genome that does affect chopstick skill. This problem, generally in observational studies, we call it confounding. In GWAS, sometimes we call it something more specific, population stratification. The idea being that our GWAS sample might be composed, perhaps not so obviously, in a number of subpopulations, samples from distinct subpopulations, each somewhat genetically distinct from the others, and therefore leading to this kind of problem. In general, I don't think that this is a big problem in GWAS. You mentioned how one thing we can do is look at the protein coding genes that the top SNPs in a GWAS are located in or near, and you can see which tissues they're expressed in. You can even calculate the top 10% of genes in the genome expressed in a certain type of tissue or even cell type these days. What fraction of the heritability of the trait is due to SNPs in or near those genes? How many total SNPs are in that category? And then you can see that if the SNPs punch above their weight in terms of how much they contribute to heritability, you know, these SNPs that are in or near the top 10% of genes expressed in the central nervous system, say. That can tell you that that we have an enrichment, as we call it. And these kinds of expression data sets, if that's what you're looking at, expression in a certain cell or tissue type, there are various normalizations you can do. So you can account for the fact that there are certain tissues, such as testes or the central nervous system, where a lot of genes just tend to be generally expressed. Now, when we apply these techniques to various GWAS phenotypes, the results tend to be basically, you get very different results depending on the phenotype that is being studied in the GWAS. For example, if the trait is Crohn's disease, your top tissues and pathways where the gene products participate in have to do with the immune system and the various cell types in the immune response. When the phenotype is height, then your top tissues are skeletal tissue, cartilage. Your top pathways are basically the development of the skeletal system. Sometimes we get surprises. So for example, in a GWAS of migraine headache, the investigators were expecting the top results to be brain. There were hypotheses about how migraine is caused by dysfunction in serotonin and other neurotransmitters, but it turned out that the top results had to do with the cardiovascular system. That doesn't mean that it's not the brain, because there are definitely blood vessels innervating the brain. But so basically, the general picture is that these biological annotation methods do deliver trait-specific results, mostly the results are in line with your prior intuitions, enough so that when you get, say, a surprising result or a contested result, you can be probably pretty confident that the result has some validity. Now, when we apply these tools to behavioral traits such as years of education, IQ, bipolar disorder, schizophrenia, and so on, the results are pretty squarely and specifically highlighting the central nervous system. Broadly speaking, it can be either the development of the brain from, you know, progenitor cells, and then there's proliferation of those progenitor cells, and then the genesis of the neurons themselves, and then adopting specific cellular identities, migrating to their ultimate locations in the overall structure of the brain, the growth of dendrites and axons, which the neurons use to communicate with each other. Another broad category of results has to do with communication between neurons at the synapse. The synapse is the term we use to describe sort of the juncture at which the output cable of one neuron pings the input tree of another neuron. And and the fact that, you know, these are not things we generally hit, and sometimes we don't even hit it when we're looking for it, as in the case of the migraine phenotype. Although there's been follow-up GWAS that have done better, I think, phenotyping of, like, well, maybe there's different kinds of migraine, and then there's been stronger support for neural involvement. But anyway, the general point is that when the biological annotation results are telling us that the main tissue of action is the brain, and this is not something we observe for other traits studied in GWAS, this is telling us that we're, I mean, something like population stratification, for example, is expected to affect every SNP across the genome. It's not something that's expected to just pull out the SNPs that happen to be in or near genes most highly expressed in the brain, or that are annotated in gene ontology as having something to do with the synapse. So that is pretty compelling evidence that these results are not driven by primarily confounding or population stratification. There is a more direct, in some sense, classical genetic way of addressing the issue of causation. Back in the 1950s, Ronald Fisher came out with a paper where he pointed out that, that there's a close analogy between randomization and experimental design, and the randomization that naturally occurs in Mendelian segregation. So you at each site in your genome, you actually have two genes, one from your mother, the other from your father. And when the time comes for you to become a parent yourself, the question arises, well, which one goes? Well, Mendel discovered the answer to this. It turns out that just one of them goes, and the choice appears to be completely random. Later, at the turn of the century, geneticists were able to observe chromosomes in grasshoppers and these various insects they were studying, and they could actually see that, yes, during gametogenesis, when a parent is forming a gamete that might end up becoming a member of the next generation, that when they can mark the chromosomes, which one goes, is totally random. It's a coin flip. And so Fisher pointed out that that this was actually the idea that inspired him to coin the term factorial design in the theory of experiments. He had already come up with the term, or it was a term in general use already, factors to describe what today I guess we might call loci or SNPs or sites. And he exploited the combinatorics of random combination to derive all kinds of things in his 1918 paper, laying the foundations of quantitative genetics. And later, when he pondered the problem of, well, you know, we want to know whether this fertilizer is better than this one, but there's all kinds of confounding factors. You know, these two plots that I want to use for my experiment, one might have inherently better soil than the other one. One might be exposed to more sunlight than the other one. And his insight that we can overcome all these problems by allotting the fertilizers, the experimental treatments, in a random manner. He noted the parallel to the genetic case, and that's why he came up with the term factorial design after Mendelian factors. And anyway, he pointed out that he noted that, and so basically, what that means is that you can actually set up something that is basically equivalent to a randomized experiment. The simplest way to think about this is, suppose that you have a genotyped family with two siblings, two offspring. So within each family, after you fix the genotypes of the parents, whether, you know, a sibling has, suppose you've done a GWAS of a trait, but it's sort of just a population sample. There's no control for confounding. So you wonder, you have some top SNPs. At each SNP, there's two alleles, two genetic variants. One is associated with more years of education, the other with less. So let's call the former the plus allele and the latter the minus allele. But you're wondering, it could be that the plus just looks like plus because of population stratification or some other form of confounding. So you can turn to the natural randomization that we find within families, and you can ask, does the offspring who purely by random chance has a higher number of plus alleles than the other sibling, does that sibling tend to go on to have a higher phenotype? In this case, more years of education. We have two papers coming out that basically tackle this very issue for a number of phenotypes using two approaches. One is to actually do what I just said, which is to look at genotype siblings. The other approach, which will come out in the paper you just mentioned, EA4, did you mention that? Well, anyway, it's kind of not as obvious. What we do is we control for the what we call the polygenic scores of the parents, and then we look at whether the offspring polygenic scores continue to be correlated with the phenotype in the way you would expect from the population GWAS. The reason why this works is because, well, you know, if you control for the parental polygenic score, so a polygenic score is basically just a single number you get out of adding up how many plus alleles a person has. Across all SNPs in the genome. So basically a higher polygenic score means you have a higher genetic contribution to that particular phenotype. Often we think polygenic score plus environmental contribution equals the phenotype. So in the second approach, we can control for the parental polygenic scores and then see if the offspring polygenic scores continue to predict the phenotype. Again, once you control for the parental polygenic scores, whether an offspring has a high or a low polygenic score relative to the parents is purely due to random Mendelian segregation. In both of these approaches, we find that generally the population GWAS is giving us mostly causal signal. That is, mm-hmm. If we look at BMI, the BMI effect estimated within families or controlling for the parental polygenic scores, the regression coefficient is like 96% of what we see in the population uncontrolled GWAS. Height, it's like something like 91%. IQ is about 83% with a somewhat larger standard error. So basically, this is saying that for all these phenotypes, height, BMI, IQ, in the SIBSHIP paper, we have a number of others. if you have more of the plus alleles as identified in the population GWAS, you do have a higher value of that phenotype, and this is due to the causal effect of those SNPs or SNPs that are highly correlated with them due to the fact that in, you know, close neighbors in the genome tend to be highly correlated. Now, there is one phenotype that stands out from this trend that I just described. That is years of education. Years of education, we do see a sharp decline when we look at the causal effect within families or controlling for the parental polygenic scores. So there it falls to like something roughly 55%. So, you know, how much do we expect your years of education to go up with a given increment in the genetic score? Well, the population GWAS gives us what seems to be the answer, but the real answer, estimated with a stronger causal design, is like 55% of that. Why years of education is different from the other phenotypes, maybe we can talk about that later.
Yeah, yeah.
How's that for a starting point?
No, it's a good starting point. I want you to dig deep because I think that's why people are, that's what we need to do at this point, because there's so much smoke out there. One of the big things, let me point out, you talked about stratification, and just to be clear for people, I think you made it clear what it was, but, you know, different populations are different. And so when you do an association in a mixed sample, there's going to be a lot of correlations just due to population differences that have nothing to do with the causes, right, in terms of a mechanistic sense. One question that I want to ask is a big thing in, and so you're talking about educational attainment and the attenuation of the effect. One of the big issues that Coop and Prezworski make in regards to Harden's book, and I think it's just an issue in behavior genetics, if you have to speak to the public, is the Evolutionary breakdown of the difference between family-based designs, which are just like best of breed, right, in terms of figuring out variation in siblings, and two population-based designs. And what would you say to that in terms of, you know, inferring heritability and causality from quote-unquote unrelated individuals in broader populations, as opposed to variation among siblings? And just for the listener, siblings themselves vary in their genetic contribution from parents, as James was saying. And so you have a situation where siblings differ in height, they differ in intelligence, they differ in disposition, and some of that difference presumably is due to genetics. And if you can trace the genetics, that's much more useful because you have a common environment in theory, right? What do you think about people who are skeptical of in terms of like drawing conclusions from family-based designs to populations or vice versa, if that question makes sense?
By family-based designs, Razib, do you mean like the old-fashioned, biometrical studies where we look at twins and parents, correlations between parents and their offspring without any DNA data?
No, I'm talking about GWAS. I'm talking about like DNA analyses of like looking at, sibling cohorts or sibling pairs, and looking at like the variation in, so variation of a characteristic within a family and how that tracks genes, right?
I would say that there are some legitimate questions there. So for example, we can use these techniques such as GREML. GREML stands for genomic. Well, it's a kind of a clever acronym because it can stand for two different things. But anyway, the basic idea of GREML is, well, you have population GWAS data, and basically, you can see whether people who are just randomly by chance slightly more genetically similar. For example, if you can think of two people, Razib, your friend A and your friend B, and they're both of your genetic background, so that there's no further issues of stratification or obvious stratification. Just by sheer chance, even if you're not really related any more closely than fourth cousins or whatever, just by sheer chance, you're going to be maybe slightly more genetically similar to A than to B. Like the way we calculate it, your genetic similarity to A might be 0.005, and then to B might be negative 0.004 or something like that. Then we can ask the question, suppose we have phenotypic measurements for you and your two friends. Are you slightly more similar phenotypically? Is your phenotype slightly closer to that of A than to B? And of course, there's just a lot of random fluctuation there, but we can systematically look at this over all pairs of individuals in our sample. And there might be tens or hundreds of thousands of such pairs nowadays. And then from that, we can back out an estimate of the heritability of the trait. The more heritable the trait is, the greater the fraction of its individual differences are due to genetic differences. Basically, the stronger your resemblance will be to other members of your population who are slightly genetically more similar to you. Now, this method, one issue with this method, there's several that could be raised, is that it tends to give estimates that are smaller than traditional estimates of heritability from like twins and so on. For example, studies of twins separated at birth, or even, you know, comparing monozygotic or identical twins to dizygotic or fraternal twins. If you do that, you'll get, the heritability of IQ, say, is like 0.6 or 0.7 or 0.75, something like that. You do GCTA and you get, or GREML, you get answers more like 0.3 or 0.25. And this is a general phenomenon, not only for behavioral traits, but diseases and anthropometric traits. There's a gap between the GREML heritability and the old-fashioned twin or biometrical heritability. Now, the answer to that, we used to think, well, that's to be expected because in GWAS, we only measure common variants. A common variant or a common SNP is a SNP where both alleles are pretty frequent in the population. So if one allele is at 0.3 and the other is at 0.7, one is at 0.16, the other is at 0.84, that's a common SNP. But then you have a lot of SNPs that we mostly do not look at in GWAS, where it might be like 0.001, 0.999. Those are called rare variants. We typically do not study these in GWAS for a number of reasons. One being that when we create a genotyping chip, we have to know where the SNPs are, and it's easier to know where the common SNPs are because in a small sample, you're going to miss a lot of rare variants. So it used to be thought, and we still mostly think, that there's going to be a gap between the GREML heritability and the old-fashioned twin heritability because in GWAS, we only get the common variants, and we don't get the rare variants. We're starting to wonder about that nowadays because well, for example, Alexander Young, Augie Kong, and a number of people came up with a very clever modification of the GREML technique that basically, it's basically a clever method that avoids any possibility of an environmental contribution to, well, maybe not totally eliminate, but substantially reduce the possibility of some kind of strange environmental confounding or inflation of the heritability estimate. Also, it's essentially what we would call a it's basically a method that should get you the heritability that's due to rare variants as well, because it's due to segregation of large chunks of the genome. And the numbers for the heritabilities, including years of education that came out of that analysis, don't seem, for the most part, to be completely converging on twin heritabilities. And also, for a number of phenotypes, I happen to know, maybe not all this has been published yet, but we're starting to dig more into the rare SNPs, sometimes using whole genome sequencing, where we can get everything. And some traits, it looks like, yeah, we are going to get convergence. For height, for example, it looks like if you do whole genome sequencing, you get everything, including the rare stuff. You are going to match up the twin heritabilities and the DNA-based heritabilities. But there's some other traits. I know, I don't know, like substance use, where we don't seem to be adding a lot of heritability as we get down into lower and lower allele frequencies, more and more rare stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a question. Is there going to be a true failure of convergence? And if so, what would be the explanation? I mean, I can get into that, but I don't know. I feel like I've talked for a while now. So I wonder, what do you want to go from there?
Yeah. So let's, EA4, we got 3.4 million samples. You know, I think a lot of the listeners will like know a little bit about EA3. That's like on the order of a million, right? Or 2 million or something. What are we doing in EA4? Why is it in advance? You know, why do we keep needing more and more samples? Like, you know, what juice are we getting out of this? Like, tell us the top line. Like, what would you tell people?
I've noticed over the years that what I find interesting doesn't tend to overlap too much with others find interesting. Others tend to find, well, how well can you predict a person's actual years of education with your genetic score? They seem chiefly interested in that. I would say that the most interesting thing about our latest GWAS of years of education, EA4, because there have been three previous ones, with our sample of about 3 million individuals, is the light that it sheds on what we call dominance and inbreeding depression. So how do I start explaining this? Well, let me start.
I think like listeners will kind of know what dominance and recessive expression are. You know, talk about like dominance coefficients and stuff like that and additivity, and then I think they'll get it.
So what we do in a GWAS is we basically do linear regression. So at a given SNP, we have three genotypes if there are two alleles. So if we call the alleles A and B, let's call them minus and plus. So then you have the three genotypes, minus, 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 plus, and plus, plus. And we would call them that because suppose this SNP was a hit and it was correlated with years of education. That means that plus minus being higher than minus minus, and then in turn plus plus being higher than plus minus in terms of like years of education. So maybe having one plus leads to you having on average one more week of education than someone who's minus, who has one fewer plus. And so if you imagine that these three data points, you have on the x-axis the three genotypes ranging from minus minus all the way to the other homozygote plus plus. On the y-axis, you have years of education, the unit being weeks of education, because that's what we're talking about, really, really small effects. So the simplest possible case is that those three data points are on a straight line. The minus minus maps onto maybe 160 months of education, minus plus maps onto 161 months, and then plus plus maps onto 162 months of education, something like that. But then you might think, when in regression do the data points lie on the line exactly? Couldn't it be that the conditional averages of the three genotypes, well, perhaps showing some increasing tendency, don't exactly lie in a straight line? Maybe after fitting the best line you can, maybe the heterozygote, the minus plus, is slightly above the line. And then maybe the two homozygotes are slightly beneath it, okay? So we call those deviations dominance deviations. The reason why we call them that is it comes from dominance, dominant and recessive in you know, introductory genetics, as Mendel discovered it, he discovered that, well, you know, sometimes, you know, a phenotypic state is brought about by one copy of the causal allele, and then two copies of the causal allele doesn't change anything, doesn't add much as far as the observable phenotype goes. So in that case where, you know, one copy of the causal allele suffices to bring about the phenotype, we call that phenotypic state dominant, or we call the underlying causal allele dominant, the idea being it dominates the other allele, the recessive allele. So this is obviously a non-additive or a non-linear relationship. As we step over from minus minus to minus plus, boom, we have the phenotype. And then going over one more step from minus plus to plus plus, yeah, the two phenotypic states are the same. So that's not a straight line. So basically, with our huge sample size, we have the statistical power to test SNP by SNP. Is there any kind of non-additive relationship among those three conditional phenotypes, average phenotypes? I mean, in theory, you could have a situation where the order does not even is not even monotonic. For example, we could have a case where, you can imagine it anyway, where the heterozygote has the highest average phenotype. That as you go from, well, let's call them letters now, from AA to AB, your education goes up. But then as we go from AB to BB, it goes down again. So we call that overdominance. Probably the most well-known example of that is the sickle cell trait and fitness, where with respect to fitness, the highest phenotype is the heterozygote, because those are best protected against malaria, falciparum malaria, whereas one homozygote is vulnerable to it, and the other homozygote is fatally afflicted by sickle cell disease. Now, overdominance was something that was popular with population geneticists some decades ago as an explanation of why there's so much genetic variation, possibly. Although even as early as 1983, Motu Kimura complained in his book, The Neutral Theory of Molecular Evolution, that overdominance is way oversold. Whenever people trot out an example, this is almost always the only example they come up with, the sickle cell trait. And now, in 2022, we can actually directly assess for a particular phenotype, SNP by SNP, whether there's any kind of overdominance or any kind of deviation from additivity at all. And what I find pretty remarkable is that we find no statistical evidence of any deviation from perfect straight lines. The three data points always lying on a straight line. We have immense statistical power to detect any, you know, overdominant or other kinds of non-additive deviations. Our data are consistent with there being none. Well, at one level, at another level, there's some, but at one level, for example, the Manhattan plot of the GWAS, the
what is the Manhattan plot, just for the listener?
The Manhattan plot is a plot that we have on the x-axis, all the SNPs studied in the GWAS, arrayed by genomic location, so chromosomes, and then position within chromosomes. On the y-axis, we have the strength of association. So the higher the data point of the SNP, the more strongly correlated it is with the phenotype. They call this a Manhattan plot because you have all these peaks where you see signals, and it kind of looks like the landscape of a city. If you look at the Manhattan plot for the dominance GWAS, that is, we're not looking for whether a SNP is correlated with years of education. We're looking for whether there is a significant deviation of the three data points at a SNP from a straight line. The Manhattan plots, there's nothing. There's nothing. It looks like a uniform distribution of p-values. The average chi-square statistic in the dominance GWAS is 1. The expectation of a chi-square distribution with 1 degree of freedom is 1, which means that the null hypothesis is true every single time. Pretty remarkable.
So that is not in line with, I mean, did you just think that there was going to be more dominance effect?
Well, I mean, there must be dominance somewhere because it's pretty clear that there is inbreeding depression for years of education and a trait with which it's highly genetically correlated, IQ. That is that if the parents are fairly closely related, father, daughter, brother, sister, or even first cousins, we tend to observe a lower educational attainment or IQ than we otherwise would. This shows that there must be dominance that, for example, this could be caused by the heterozygote tending to be slightly closer to the plus plus homozygote than to the minus minus homozygote. Basically, what inbreeding does is it reduces the number of heterozygotes and increases the number of homozygotes. So basically, if you're minus minus, under an inbreeding scheme of mating, you are less likely to mate with a plus plus person at a given SNP than you would under random mating. And so basically, the heterozygotes at that SNP you could have produced with a plus plus mate, you being minus minus, don't get produced, and we end up with more homozygotes. A colorful way to think of it is that what inbreeding does is it takes two heterozygotes, say, plus minus, it busts them apart, and then rearranges the four constituent genes so that out of it you get a minus minus and a plus plus. I don't know if that image helps, but it helps me. So basically, with inbreeding, you end up with a deficit of heterozygotes. Now, if the plus plus homozygote, if the heterozygotes are slightly closer to the plus plus, then the excess plus pluses that are produced do not compensate for the excess minuses, minus minuses that are produced. That is, for every conversion to every transition of a plus minus to a plus plus, that does not balance out a transition of a plus minus to a minus minus as the population inbreeds more, because the plus minus was closer to the plus plus in the first place under that kind of non-additivity. So that could explain inbreeding depression. So the fact that inbreeding depression does occur for this phenotype would kind of lead you to expect that you might observe some dominance a little bit in our GWAS of years of education, but we don't. Now, there are two ways to reconcile this. Why do we not detect any GWAS at the dominance at the DNA level? Well, we know from phenotypic effects of inbreeding that there must be some somewhere. Well, it could be that a tendency for the heterozygote to be slightly closer to the plus plus homozygote is indeed so slight that even though being statistically undetectable in a sample of millions on a SNP by SNP basis, nevertheless, the infinitesimal deviation of the heterozygote toward the plus plus homozygote, when aggregated over thousands and thousands of causal SNPs, could add up to a little bit of inbreeding depression. And that our data are actually consistent with that. Using a method devised by Loic Yengo and his colleagues, we do find in our dominance GWAS, when we aggregate all the statistics, even though we see nothing on a SNP-by-SNP basis, a little something does add up over all the SNPs, and the aggregate statistics predict that an offspring of two first cousins will obtain a years of education about a month. The decrement is predicted to be about a month. Now, we know that it seems that the phenotypic decrement that we actually observe between first cousins is more than a month. So it could be that leads to our second explanation, which is that there is much more dominance at rare SNPs. that we do not have in our GWAS. And indeed, there are many known recessive Mendelian disorders where one of the symptoms is intellectual disability. Now, this fits nicely with some results that were obtained back in the day by the geneticist James Crow and either a colleague or a student of his named, I think, Greenberg. It's a bit confusing because she has multiple last names in the literature because I think she got married. But basically what Crow and apologies if I'm not don't have quite the name right, Greenberg, but what they found is in studies of Drosophila, they were studying this issue of dominance with respect to fitness. Is there dominance? Is there over-dominance? How much is there? And what they basically found is that that at mutations or SNPs in Drosophila of small effect, there tends to be very little dominance. Now, remember that common SNPs in GWAS, and this is because of the influence of natural selection, common SNPs in GWAS do tend to have small effects. So in years of education, we're talking about like months, weeks being the increment per allele. So that's consistent with what was observed into the Drosophila, that mutations of small effect are estimated to be almost perfectly additive. In contrast, mutations of larger effects on fitness tend to show some kind of dominance-recessive relationship where often what would happen is that the one copy of the mutation will decrease fitness by like 1% or something. But then the second increment, the second being a homozygote, might be lethal. And so basically the model that was put forth by Crow, and also there was a big review paper about this, co-author Simmons, Crow and colleagues, was that it's by analogy to a Taylor series expansion. So basically, if you have any kind of crazy curve, like, on the x-axis, you're increasing something, and then you're observing what changes on something else in the y-axis, you can have some crazy curve that is not a straight line or maybe even is non-monotonic. It starts, it goes up, and then it goes down. But if you zoom in with a microscope on any small range, over any small range of the curve, on any small step on the x-axis, and then you look at that curve again, that curve always looks like a straight line. Basically, you can approximate any straight line by putting together any curvy line, by piecing together many straight lines. And so Crow et al. Proposed that when you have a mutation that perturbs an underlying biological system, like, for example, say it's a mutation in an enhancer and it just very slightly decreases the affinity for binding a transcription factor, that will always have a close to additive effect because it's like you're zooming in on a curve over a very small part of its range. However, if you have a mutation that has a big, that exerts a big perturbation on its underlying biological system, like, for example, a protein truncating mutation, well, often you can get by with half of that protein and then you suffer only a 1% reduction in your fitness, and then but then you lose the protein altogether and now it's lethal. So basically, if you monkey around with the underlying biology a lot, you see nonlinearity. If you tinker with the underlying biology very little, you'll see an additive effect. I think that what's very striking to me is how we get a very striking confirmation of these results that were obtained earlier in a model organism using techniques that must seem very crude to us today. But it confirms this basic principle that Mutations of small effect are additive, and mutations of larger effect, which we tend not to become common because of selection against them. It's there where it seems that the bulk of dominance, non-additivity, and hence inbreeding depression occurs. Well, I should take that back. There's some ambiguity about, well, how much of inbreeding depression is due to rare variants versus common variants. It might depend on the phenotype, but at least just looking at our paper, it looks like, well, there's a very minute contribution from common SNPs, and there seems to be a much larger contribution from rare SNPs.
Interesting.
I also want to point out something else that's striking.
Okay.
Things, additivity, dominance, and epistasis, and so on. This can depend on the scaling of the phenotype. For example, you take the log of the phenotype or the square root, or you transform it in such a way that it's extremely skewed, or you reduce skew that was originally there. This can, in theory, affect the additivity of the underlying genetic architecture. For example, you take a trait that's normally distributed, and it's normal because of the central limit theorem that all its causes are small and they just add up. Well, in that case, it would not be too surprising if the genetic architecture was very close to additive. But then suppose you took, you transformed the trait such that it had a long tail now. Then the underlying genetic architecture, it should not be additive. It should be multiplicative or something. Now, in years of education, we've not taken particular care with the scaling of the trait. In fact, I think if you look at histograms of it, it's a funny distribution where, you know, there's a lot of high school graduates, but then there's, I don't know, you look at the next category, which is some college, and it doesn't look normal, or it looks weird, not natural. And then we have so we didn't scale the trait to make it as additive as possible, and yet with a seemingly arbitrary scaling of whatever this trait really is, we look and we discover that there is almost no non-additivity within SNPs. That is, virtually no dominance at the common SNPs.
Yeah, so I mean, this is, so for geneticists, obviously, I actually agree. It was kind of a surprising result how additive everything is. I mean, maybe it shouldn't be surprising now. We need to update our priors. But I mean, obviously, I'm glad you talked about it because the important stuff should be foregrounded. But for let's say a more general interest listener, what does EA4 add on top of what EA3 provided, which you were pretty high? I think you were second author on EA3.
One of those. Yeah.
Yeah. What do we got here? Like, why should they pay attention to it? Yes, it's over 3 million. I mean, that's a great number. But what is the result between EA4 to EA3 where it's that's kind of interesting. You know, I think there's some assortative mating stuff in there. What else do you see?
Well, let me turn now to the thing it seems to me that most people are interested in, which is how much prediction R squared can you get out of the polygenic score? Recalling that the polygenic score is just basically adding up how many plus alleles people have. You can make the polygenic score more accurate by getting better weights for each SNP, and that's what you get with increased sample size in the GWAS. So depending on the validation sample, we can predict with our latest polygenic score 13 to 16% of the phenotypic variants. So after tripling a sample size, that basically means that we went from 11 to 13 to basically 13 to 16. Now, increase in the accuracy does start to hit an asymptote, so it seems like we're kind of in that range where a tripling of sample size leads to what was already, a few percent. There's another way to think about this, though. We can divide our prediction sample or validation sample into deciles based on the polygenic score. So the bottom 10% of individuals in terms of polygenic score, the next 10%, the next 10%, and we have 10 deciles. So once we array people that way, according to their polygenic scores, we see that from the bottom to the top 10%, there is roughly like a 9-10-fold increase in the rate of college completion. So in one of our validation samples, the bottom 10% is like a 7% college completion rate, and the top 10% is a 70% roughly. So put that way, this seems like a pretty non-trivial prediction. For example, it's a better prediction of the individual's years of education than parental income. There is a caveat, though, because of what I mentioned earlier, which is that there appears to be a confounding that specifically affects the years of education GWAS, such that the population estimate of the causal effect is inflated. So as I mentioned earlier, when we look at what happens when you control for parental polygenic scores,
yeah,
we see a reduction down to about 55% of the polygenic score coefficient that we see in without the control. Now, why is that? A naive thought, and I think there definitely is some truth to this, although recent preprints and so on make it a little more complicated, is that education is a component of social class where, for example, where it's easiest for parents to help you obtain it, or not by maybe not caring so much. A few years ago, there were headlines about where parents would actually bribe college admissions officials to get them into, you know, top 50 universities and so on. But you can imagine all kinds of other ways that parents can help. There are persistent rumors that there's a Harvard number, such that if you donate to Harvard more than that number, your kid can get into Harvard despite having otherwise less than stellar credentials. You can imagine other things, just knowing that, well, you know, if you want to get into this university, you gotta, you know, write this kind of college admissions essay. So if that's really the case, that highly educated parents or parents who are high in SES can sort of help their offspring who are not particularly talented to get into college. Basically, we have this confounding path that runs from the individual's genetics to the parent's genetics, to the parent's phenotype, actually, or whatever it is that is that this help or whatever you want to call it is acting through, to the parent genetics. Therefore, there's this confounding. Now, the story might be more complicated that it's not maybe that your parents are directly helping you, but it could be that your parents, the parents' family and family members, that you're part of a kind of, stratum, let's call it, population stratification. And that within this stratum, there's like just this environmental increment or decrement to your years of education. There is this phenomenon operating with years of education that we don't see much evidence of in other phenotypes. And that's another feature of our paper. We're able to quantify this more precisely than in previous papers. And also, interestingly, look at three other phenotypes, height, BMI, and IQ. For none of those three phenotypes do we see anywhere near such a strong attenuation. which is kind of strange. I might have thought that BMI, that I don't know, the diet might be shared within a family through environmental mechanism, but apparently not. And so one thing we're able to shed some light on it is the extent to which this is a phenomenon that is the so-called genetic nurture, or more specifically, this attenuation of the GWAS coefficients or the polygenic score within families, how specific this phenomenon is to years of education.
Yeah, actually, can you talk about what genetic nurture is? Because it's a really big deal right now, and I think it's confusing a lot of people.
Well, genetic nurture is basically charge. Genetic nurture is just what I've been talking about. This is something that behavioral geneticists, well, I don't know. I mean, journal reviewers will lecture you about terminology. But in my book, we used to call this passive gene-environment interaction, correlation, sorry, which basically means that individuals who have a genetic disposition for a certain phenotype might also tend to grow up in environments with a similar effect on that phenotype. And it was already imagined by sort of the pioneers of this concept in the 70s, Robert Plowman, John Lowland, John DeFries, and then later Sandra Scar and Richard Weinberg, that a major mechanism of this might be, for example, it might be that more intelligent parents tend to provide a better environment for their kids by perhaps reading to them more, or having more things like books or maps or globes or microscopes, things like that in the house. And through this process of just passively finding themselves with parents who happen to have a similar genotype, you have this correlation between the genetic value of the phenotype and the environmental value of the phenotype in terms of the decomposition of the trait into genetic plus environmental. So this was an idea that was hypothesized, and it was invoked to explain certain phenomena, such as the tendency of estimated contribution of shared environment to individual differences declining as people get older, while on the other hand, the heritability tends to increase. It was thought that, well, maybe what's happening is that beginning from a passive correlation between genetics and environment, people start to move into environments that are more of their own making, or that are evoked by their own behaviors. And anyway, this was an idea that was around in the 70s, 80s, 90s. Now, what has happened is that with GWAS and DNA level data, we seem to have DNA level confirmation of this kind of process occurring, although not so much for IQ, apparently, but more years of education. And sometimes we have this tendency of something having been hypothesized or inferred through clever techniques before GWAS and, you know, Human Genome Project and DNA level data. But then subsequently, when we observe it or confirm it with the DNA level data, it becomes more real and exciting for some reason. So this reduction that I've talked about, that is when we estimate how strongly a correlated a SNP is with years of education in a population GWAS with no control for confounding. And then we observe that within families, the coefficient is only about 55% as large. Genetic nurture or passive gene environment correlation, take your pick. This is the likely explanation of that, at least to some extent. People with a genetic disposition toward more years of education find themselves in families or in strata of society that tend to promote years of education, and therefore there's this confounding path that runs from the individual's genetics to the parental genetics, or the genetics of their little stratum, if we think in terms of population stratification, to the environment in which they grew up, and then down to their phenotype. And that looping confounding path that I've just sketched out is on in surplus of or on top of the direct causal path from the individual's genetics to the phenotype. And the existence of both of these paths is what leads to the inflation of the causal estimate in the uncontrolled GWAS. Mm-hmm. So this was first published in 2018, paper in Science by Augustine Kong and a number of people. There were a number of people who were working on it pretty much simultaneously. I'll just mention, you know, Timothy Bates, a group with Daniel Belsky, also a paper by my current postdoc, Emily Willoughby, a number of people. But Kong et al. Were first, and they called it genetic nurture. And this is a term that has stuck and caught on, in addition to our older terminology of passive gene environment correlation.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, I really appreciate that elaboration, because, you know, there are all these terms, and sometimes the media is not the best at elaborating what's going on. So we got, like, I think, like 3.4 million samples. You have, like, all of these results. What is it?
We should definitely not forget about one other thing. You mentioned assorted mating.
Yes. That's one of the big, I think that'll, you know, yeah.
So by assorted mating, superficially, it's somewhat similar to inbreeding, which we talked about earlier. But assorted mating means, I guess it can have a narrow meaning and a broad meaning. A broad meaning is just what the phenomenon of spouses or parents having similar phenotypes. So if I have my data file and one of my columns is each row corresponds to a family, and one of my columns is the dad's height, and another column in my data file is the mother's height. If I calculate the correlation between those two columns, then it comes out 0.3, which means positive 0.3, which means that a tall father tends to have be paired up with a mother who is also above average in height. This is what we call assortive mating, the idea being it seems that people are sorting by this phenotype. Now, we're not sure in every case what's going on in people's heads that leads to the correlation. Is it that if you're a certain height, you prefer a partner who is also of that height, normalizing for the sex difference in height? Or is it that everyone prefers to have a tall partner, but the tall people, since they're most able to act on their preference, take, you know, most of the tall people, and then the short people have to settle for other short people. Probably it depends on the phenotype. There are other possibilities besides those two. But assorted mating leads to many important genetic consequences. For example, assorted mating can also contribute to a reduction of the within-family regression coefficient relative to the population regression coefficient. Although its effect there is relatively minor, it seems. But more importantly, assorted mating has effects on the genetic variance. It leads to an increase in the genetic variance. Basically, assorted mating, so if you're a tall parent, under random mating, we would expect your partner to be of the average phenotype, but under assorted mating, we expect your partner to have an above average phenotype. And this basically means, I think it's fairly intuitive, that extreme genotypes become more probable in the population. And this is basically an increase.
Like Yao Ming, parents are super tall basketball players and produced him, right?
Yes. His parents were both basketball players, and they were encouraged to get married and be fruitful, produce more basketball players. The intuition ought to be that In a population where talls are ending up with talls, Yao Ming is more likely. So I was talking about mechanisms of assorted mating. What is going on in people's heads, or what are their preferences, or what is the nature of the social structure in the population that leads to the correlation between mates? So one way you can get at that is to see if there's what we can do is correlate the calculation between the polygenic scores of the spouses or the parents. So you can ask, is there not only a correlation between their phenotypes, what you can actually observe, but also a correlation between their genetic scores for that phenotype? And it turns out that yes, there is. For example, for height, not only are people's actual heights correlated, but the genetic scores of their heights are correlated as well. Same for years of education. For the other phenotypes, the polygenic scores don't seem powerful enough, or the assortative mating is not strong enough to jointly produce a significant result, but we have at least height and years of education. So one thing you can do is, when you look at that correlation between the genetic scores, control for the phenotypes. That is, if I, for example, one way to think of it is I pick out a subset of people who have partners who just tend to have, who just happen to have similar phenotypes. Is there still a tendency for their genetic scores to be similar? If not, that means that the results are strongly consistent with a way of mating that is purely by matching according to the phenotype. The idea is that if you're looking for a partner, all you care about is the partner's actual height, or actual years of education, actual degree level. You don't, you're not using X-ray vision to look down at the underlying genotype and saying, "Well, I don't care if you're phenotypically tall. I want you to be genetically tall too." Does that make sense?
Yeah. I mean, this issue is actually like really live in a lot of people's lives, insofar as, you know, they naively assume blending inheritance and mid-parent values on some traits that are not quite heritable, or the heritability is not like super high, and it turns out that you know, the offspring aren't up to what they were expecting, the expected value, so to speak. So this is like a real thing. Like, a lot of the stuff we're talking about here are like phenotypes we care about. You know, obviously they're salient, easy to measure, like height, but, you know, intelligence, like issues relating to psychopathology and mental illness. So it's not just like abstract. So, I mean, you know, now that we talked about sort of many, I would like to close this out just by, so we got 3 million. Is there anything you can, so you talked about rare variants earlier, where it's like, you know, there are variants that are in families, and like, I think we have like 30 to 60 de novo mutations, new mutations unique to us, although you can correct me on that, James, although most of that should not be functional, like only one, less than 1% of the genome is producing like protein. 80,
although it depends on your parents' ages, but yeah, something like that, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And so, okay, so like we get to 30 million, we get to 300, I mean, these numbers will happen in the next decade. I mean, we could get billion in 20 years, you know? Well, I mean, it depends on the data. I mean, I'm sure like Facebook has billions of people. I mean, I'm not trying to like present a scary scenario for people, but Facebook has billions of real IDs associated with their educational levels and all sorts of personal information. We're not that many SQL joins away from this sort of scenario. But, you know, we've talked a little bit offline about this. Like, do you think that there's much juice in educational attainment if you go from, say, 3 million to 30 million? Or are we just kind of like reaching the limits of the power of the science to actually investigate things?
Well, I don't want to speak for my co-authors. My own opinion is that... well, I mean, we did the dominance, and that turned up some fascinating results. We did find that, so there's always something interesting you can turn up. But my opinion, though, is that there's not much value in taking GWAS of height or years of education to, you know, another tripling of sample size, so that now we're at like 10 million or 20 million. There's lots of questions you can ask about, well, what more can we infer about the biology of the underlying trait? Can we do better to determine the actual causal variant? You can have a peak in the Manhattan plot, but often that will be just because that particular SNP is correlated with one or more actual causal SNPs. But these questions you can ask and the advances will depend on things that don't really have to do with the increasing of sample size in the GWAS. For example, it may be that our ability to pinpoint the causal SNPs will depend more on our ability to annotate the genome in terms of being, you know, even more precise with like, what are the boundaries of likely enhancers, and can we tell even more from actually the three-dimensional conformation of the genome, whether, you know, a SNP in this region is actually likely to be causal. Coupled with advances in more fundamental genetics, I could see us, climbing new heights, but increasing the sample size of the GWAS alone, my feeling is that we've started to hit diminishing returns. The next one with 10 million will like do stuff with epistasis, non-additive interactions between SNPs. That'll make me eat my words, but that's just my gut feeling right now.
Yeah, well, so let me just like say really quickly here, for a couple of decades now, a lot of biologists, especially molecular biologists, but not just them, have said that, you know, okay, like we have all these GWAS hits, we have all these, you know, now we know the segments of the genome that, you know, the causal effects start from. Now you need to do some molecular biological investigations, physiological investigations, look at how it actually is operationalized or is operationalizing itself structurally and mechanistically in terms of the biochemical processes and whatnot. And so I think, are you getting at that issue?
Yeah, sort of, yes. I think that if you have identified an actual causal SNP, or maybe it's not a SNP, maybe it's an indel or a short tandem repeat. There's some suggestion that, you know, repeats might actually account for some of this heritability gap I was referring to earlier. We would like to know more at least about what is the actual biological mechanism through which the SNP affects the phenotype. Is it a non-synonymous SNP? Does it change the composition of a neurotransmitter receptor? Does it change its sensitivity to a neurotransmitter? Does it change its sensitivity to voltage if it's a voltage gated channel? Does it affect the affinity of a transcription factor? And so does it depend more on the levels of the transcription of certain genes in a neuron or whatever the relevant cell type is? Does it actually have some effect on the proliferation of neurons? Does it affect the precision with which axons are guided to their targets? Does it affect the efficiency with which the machinery of neurotransmitter release is sort of recycled and reused? It would be hard work to bring together the people with the relevant expertise and the first step, which is to be really sure that we've identified some causal SNPs or causal sites, so that we're not going up a blind alley. But That would be something that would be something new and exciting, I think.
All right, so I want to close out with one last question.
I will talk about something that we haven't touched on yet, which is the light that GWAS has shed on evolutionary genetics. This is
Oh,
very important.
yeah. And with that, then let's do that. I think that's a better question or a better issue than what I was going to bring up. So just go.
For example, we found that that SNPs that are more strongly associated with phenotypes in GWAS seem to be they tend on average to be deleterious. We know that because well, they tend to be younger than other alleles of the same allele frequency. They tend to be more often found in regions that we know are evolutionarily conserved when we compare that stretch of sequence in different taxa. So this confirms something that we've suspected, but now we have confirmation that, which is that a lot of phenotypes are under some kind of stabilizing selection or a combination of stabilizing selection, which means that the extremes are penalized. It does seem that Yao Mings and people who are very short are not as favored by selection as people who are more mediocre, closer to the average. So that's a form of selection we call stabilizing selection. Also, it's likely that if a SNP has some, greater than threshold effect on a phenotype, that it experiences negative selection not only because of its direct effect on a phenotype that we're studying in the GWAS, but also because of pleiotropy, side effects on other traits. And this and these side effects will tend to be deleterious. If I make a random change in any complex high-dimensional device like these machines that we're talking on right now, changes are not likely to be improvements. Random changes are likely to degrade the function of the machine. So then this raises the question of, well, I mean, if things tend to be selected against when they affect the phenotype, why do we have all of these things, and why is there so much genetic variation underlying all this phenotypic variation? And the answer to that is kind of suggested by the GWAS results themselves, which is that we now know that there are thousands and thousands, in some cases perhaps tens of thousands, of causal SNPs affecting these phenotypes. And this is just the tip of the iceberg because only things with small effects will escape the sieve of selection to become common. And also, just by sheer chance, we know that there are many, many, many more possible sites that could affect the phenotype, but it just happens that there is not a segregating mutation there at high frequency. Which means that there are, for any given phenotype, likely millions of possible sites that, if mutated, could affect that particular phenotype. So this is giving us a picture that I think is very dramatically different from what people might have been imagining, even a decade ago, certainly throughout the history of population and quantitative genetics, where this has always been a live issue. What explains why there's so much genetic variation? There is genetic variation, despite the fact that there are selective forces that penalize variation, just because we have a big genome and 3 billion locations, and a very, very large fraction of those locations have slight and sometimes not so slight effects on various phenotypes.
No, I mean, I guess like one thing that I want to remind some of the listeners is, you know, we're talking pretty casually about millions of samples and hundreds of thousands of genomic positions and the whole genome, and like actually having like a biochemical sense structurally, physically in this world of where these mutations are and whether they're deleterious or not. For most of the 20th century, this was all theory and abstraction. So it's really amazing that we can actually just have this conversation in an almost cavalier, casual tone, because it's actually pretty amazing and miraculous that we're getting down to the brass tacks of the underlying guts of how evolution is working on the molecular biochemical, molecular biological substrate. And I think, you know, some evolutionary geneticists who are very contemptuous of behavior genetics, I think they need to understand that really the field is, I mean, in my opinion, so James may jump in and disagree, but in a way, to a great extent, it's a branch of quantitative genetics in a sense. And so it's not incredibly different aside from the fact that, okay, if you're talking about human behavior, that is extremely loaded and fraught in our culture. But the underlying concepts and the underlying toolkit is not that different. What would you say to that, James?
Yeah. So Michael Neal and Hermine Mayez, two behavioral geneticists, they have a textbook where they have a great figure showing where behavioral genetics comes from in terms of what are the various streams that have pulled together to make it today. There are some that are a bit esoteric, like you know, factor analysis and structural equation models, which come from psychology and psychometrics. But a big stream definitely is shared with the rest of quantitative genetics as it is developed in human genetics and livestock genetics, coming from Fisher and his 1918 paper, and Sewell Wright with his path tracing rules. And so in that sense, yes, there's not that great distance that some might imagine.
Well, so we've been talking for a while. I should let you go, James. It's been great talking to you. You know, everyone, the show notes are going to have the links to the various things that we've talked about. You know, I alluded here to the controversy related to behavior genetics as a field and, you know, like how does the causality work? Should we pay attention to it? Whether you think that this is a useful field or not, you will not be able to avoid it. It will impinge on your life in the next decade as we discover more and more and refine our understanding of, you know, the genetic basis of human behavioral variation, in part because, you know, just to be clear, if you don't understand the genetic and biological basis, you can't understand the rest of it. And the rest of it is also quite important in many ways. If you read books about how, you know, rates of depression have been skyrocketing across the world, I mean, you know, what's going on there, right? So I think, like, you know, we've been looking at one half of the glass, you know, full, and there's another half that can complete it, more than a half in many cases. And so let's keep that in mind. And this is why we're in it. You know, we want to just understand what makes people tick and the world around us. And this serves as a foundation for many other disciplines of social science. And I last thing I do want to say is, you know, so Paige Harden had a response to the Coop and Prezworski, you know, preprint, which a lot of population geneticists agree with, people I respect and know their stuff. The main thing that Paige said that I think a lot of them do not appreciate is many fields in social science have much lower correlations and weaker causality than behavior genetics. And those fields in social science, they have no problem relying on to make their own normative inferences and shaping their political worldviews. So what's going on here is a little interesting to me in terms of heightened scrutiny and, you know, excessive vigilance, perhaps, through motivated reasoning. I'm going to be candid. I think that some of that is happening here, and people should be cautious and wary of it. So again, James, thank you for your time. And maybe... Yeah. And like, I will also post a link to my interview with James for the Insight from, I think it was like 2018 now. It was a while ago. But, you know, listen to that one. It's really good too. And I appreciate you coming on and talking to the people, because your work is important and people are going to hear about this sort of stuff. And it's best that they hear it from the practitioners themselves as much as possible, as opposed to, you know, digested by people like me or in the media. Anyway, thank you, James. And I will see you around.
All right. You too, Razib.
This podcast for kids.